Now that we have provided an overview of the baseline equivalence standard, let's briefly review how the WWC calculates baseline equivalence effect sizes. As discussed in earlier modules in this training series, the WWC calculates effect sizes to estimate the magnitude of differences between the intervention and comparison conditions on some baseline measures of interest. The WWC uses the same effect size calculation procedures to estimate baseline equivalence effect sizes as those used for estimating intervention impacts, but the WWC calculates effect sizes in different ways based on the type of variables the study used to measure characteristics. For continuous measures, variables that have many possible values, such as standardized test scores, the WWC calculates Hedges G. For dichotomous measures, variables with only two possible categories, such as graduated or not, the WWC calculates Cox's index. Both of these measures express the effect size in standard deviation units, based on the variation of the baseline measure in the analytic sample. We will walk through how to calculate effect sizes in the next few slides. The WWC's online study review guide has tools to assist with these calculations as well. For continuous variables, the WWC calculates Hedges G to determine baseline equivalence. Hedges G is a common effect size indicator. It is calculated as the difference between the average of the characteristic for intervention group members and the average of the characteristic for comparison group members. The difference, then, is standardized to put it on a standard deviation scale. This slide shows a general equation the WWC uses to calculate a Hedges G effect size. Hedges G represents the difference between the average of a characteristic for intervention group members and the average of a characteristic for comparison group members, divided by the pooled standard deviation of that characteristic, where the pooled standard deviation is just the weighted average of each group's standard deviation. So, let us walk through this equation together. First, we see that the numerator of the effect size calculation includes B, which represents the unstandardized mean difference between the intervention and comparison groups on some baseline characteristic. This mean difference is multiplied by an omega term, which is simply the small sample size correction. This omega term is what differentiates the Hedges G effect size from the popular Cohen's D effect size you often see in the literature. The denominator of the effect size calculation then represents the pooled standard deviation, and this is what standardizes the effect size to ensure that it is in standard deviation units. So, in the denominator, we see Ni and Nc are the sample sizes for the intervention and comparison groups, respectively. The I and C indicate the intervention group and comparison groups, respectively. SDI and SDC are the unadjusted standard deviations for the intervention and comparison groups, respectively. So we see that denominator in this equation, or the pooled standard deviation, represents the weighted average of both groups' standard deviations. This equation, along with all the important equations used by the WWC, is discussed in greater detail in Appendix E of the handbook. Let's walk through an example of how to calculate a Hedges G effect size for a continuous baseline characteristic. In this example, we have sample sizes and standard deviations on a continuous baseline measure, as well as an unstandardized mean difference for the intervention and comparison groups. The difference in means between the intervention and comparison groups is 4. Let's imagine this was reported in the form of an unstandardized coefficient from a linear regression model that included a dummy variable indicating intervention group status. The standard deviation is 10 in both groups. The sample size for the intervention group is 120, and the sample size for the comparison group is 100. Plugging these numbers into the Hedges G equation, we find that Hedges G is equal to 0.4 standard deviations. This means that the intervention group average is 0.4 standard deviations larger than that of the comparison group. On this measure, the groups do not demonstrate equivalence at baseline, as the effect size is greater than 0.25 standard deviations. For dichotomous baseline variables, which are variables that have only two possible categories, the WWC uses a version of the Cox's index to calculate a baseline equivalence effect size. Common types of dichotomous variables include passing or failing a test, enrolling or not enrolling in a course, or any other variable that has two possible categories. Cox's index is designed to produce an effect size measure that is comparable to Hedges G. Here is the formula for Cox's index. The formula includes the natural logarithm function, written as ln, and an intermediary calculation called an odds ratio, written as OR. Without going into too much technical detail about the mathematical concepts, Cox's index applies the natural logarithm to the odds ratio, indexing the ratio of the odds of an event in the intervention and comparison groups. You can find more information about this formula in Appendix E of the handbook. Let's walk through an example of how to calculate Cox's index. In this example, let's say 100 students are in the intervention group and 90 students are in the comparison group. Let's say our dichotomous baseline variable of interest is whether or not students reached grade level proficiency on the mathematics test in the prior school year. In this example, 37% of the intervention group students were proficient, whereas 63% of the intervention group's students were not proficient, and 32% of the comparison group students were proficient, whereas 68% were not. To calculate the Cox's index, the percentages must be expressed as proportions out of a total of 1, as is written here. For this variable, the Cox's index effect size value is 0.13, which indicates that the intervention group average is 0.13 standard deviations larger than that of the comparison group. On this measure, the groups fall into the adjustment range, so the study authors must use an appropriate statistical adjustment procedure to control for these pre-existing baseline differences and to meet the baseline equivalence standard. The equations we just covered for Hedges G and Cox's index are general effect size formulas. However, the WWC uses different variations on these general formulas to account for differences in how study authors reported their findings. When calculating Hedges G effect sizes for continuous measures, these equations will vary depending on the type of information reported by study authors, as well as whether the study used individual or cluster-level assignment to conditions. When calculating Cox's index effect sizes for dichotomous measures, these equations also can vary depending on the type of statistical information reported by the study authors. Module 11 in this training series provides additional technical details for people interested in these variations in effect size calculations. One key point to remember is that the WWC assesses baseline equivalence on the analytic sample using baseline data. The analytic sample includes the units that the study used to assess the impacts. In the example depicted here, Imagine the colors represent characteristics of sample members in both groups at baseline. The WWC uses baseline data to determine whether the groups were similar on certain characteristics before the intervention occurred. The study randomly assigned the sample members, but attrition occurred and the study only analyzed a portion of the original sample members. The analytic sample is the group of students shown on the right. The WWC does not assess baseline equivalence on the units that the study initially randomly assigned, nor the students on the left, because baseline equivalence on the initial sample would not reflect changes to the sample through attrition. These changes could introduce bias to the impact estimates that may be detected by assessing equivalence on the analytic sample, but would not be detected by assessing equivalence of the sample members at random assignment. That is why the WWC assesses baseline equivalence on the analytic sample used to estimate impacts, namely the group on the right. Now that we have discussed the general procedures for calculating baseline equivalence effect sizes, let's consider statistical adjustments and the role they play in the baseline equivalence standard. Remember that the WWC assesses baseline equivalence for all QEDs, for compromised RCTs, and for RCTs with high risk of bias due to compositional change. In order to apply the baseline equivalence standard, the WWC will calculate a baseline equivalence effect size, and the magnitude of that effect size will determine whether a study's impact analysis requires a statistical adjustment for a baseline measure. The WWC does not require statistical adjustment for baseline differences if the baseline equivalence effect size is less than 0.05 standard deviations. However, remember, the WWC does require statistical adjustment if the baseline equivalence effect size is between 0.05 and 0.25 standard deviations. The table shown on the slide lists the statistical adjustment strategies that the WWC considers appropriate for any baseline measure. These include regression covariate adjustments in ordinary least squares models, regression covariate adjustments in hierarchical linear models, analysis of covariance, other approaches to regression covariate adjustments such as generalized linear models, matching and weighting method, and bounding techniques. Study authors might also use other types of adjustment strategies that assume a fixed relationship between the pretest and post-test, such as simple gain scores, difference in differences adjustments, or fixed effects for units of assignment and intervention period. The WWC will consider these to be acceptable adjustment strategies only if the baseline and outcome measures are from the same outcome domain and on the same measurement scale, and they have a correlation between the pretest and post-test of 0.06 or greater. Review teams may waive the requirement of having a pretest-post-test correlation of 0.06 or greater if the topic area protocol documents evidence that the correlations between pretests and post-tests of the measure typically exceed 0.6, and the exception is applied consistently for all studies reviewed under the topic area protocol.